For today's data science chalk talk, let's talk about excess generalization error. So we're going to talk about a supervised machine learning situation. So we have datums xi that are in Rn. So they're vectors of n real numbers. We've possibly converted from other data types, such as categorical variables, into this. And we have yi in the set true, false. So it's a classification problem. And we have I ranges from 1 to m. So this is how many data rows we have. Now, this is called a supervised machine learning problem because we want to find a function such that f of xi is approximately yi, or very often completely agrees with it since it only takes two values. Now, there's a common theorem that you see quite around is that basically excess generalization error is less than or equal to model size for some appropriate definition of size over m. I want to show how to prove such a thing and in what framework that sort of statement is true. The first place I saw it is in the Cortes-Vapnik paper that introduced soft margin support vector machines in 1995. I've also seen it in Christiani Shaw Taylor in 2000 Introduction to Support Vector Machines book, section 6.1, comment 6.9, page 101. But I always feel that the argument needs a little more fleshing out, which is what I'm gonna do here. So we're gonna assume that we have a very specialized machine learning algorithm, which is very deterministic and reproducible, though we could relax those conditions and get a general result that's almost identical, just have to add the word expectation very many places. So we're going to argue this in the simplest, crispest case. So we have a procedure called fit. Now fit takes a subset of 1 dot 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 m, and it returns a pair, MS, which is a model, and CS, which is a critical set, a term I will introduce. Now, the model, MS, is a map from Rn to true, false. So it is the function we hope can read off the y values. Now, fit has access to the set of rows that are subscripted by the s. So we can look at, it has knowledge of any xi for I in s and any yi for I in s. But no, it does not get to see any row that is not subscripted by s. So it only gets to see this subset of this training set. Now, the second thing it returns is the critical set. CS is a set contained in S with the following properties. Now, they're rather interesting properties. So, one, fit CS minus I doesn't equal dot model, so we'll just take the model portion off, the return, doesn't equal ms for any I in CS. So it means that if we fit on something smaller than CS, we don't get this model we got. We got something different, maybe better, maybe worse, probably worse. Second property is f of u dot model equals ms for any u such that CS contained in u contained in s. So the idea is, for instance, CS itself is such a u, that the fit, if it's given at least this set of rows, the critical set of rows, it reproduces exactly the same model it did when given the S set of rows. So this is sort of like a core. And we're going to go ahead and say, pick CS smallest such. May not be unique, there may be more than one, and there may be more than one of the same size, but let's go ahead and pick a CS minimal. So this is a rather remarkable fitting function that's incredibly deterministic and reproducible. Not all fitting functions are like this. The support vector machine function is like this. So this is this was realized by some fitters. So when you have this sort of fitter, then this sort of statement is quite easy to demonstrate. And I'm going to go ahead and do that here. So the argument is in two parts. So one, a leave one out argument to estimate this, and two, a bound on the above argument. So we're going to show how a laborious leave one out calculation could estimate this excess generalization error rate, which is how many more errors in a rate are made in new future data versus the error rate seen during training. So often the error rate seen during training is an underestimate of how well the model will perform, or sorry, an overestimate or overconfidence of how well the model will perform in the future. That difference of how you thought the model performed on training versus how the model is going to perform in the future is called the excess generalization error rate. So we're going to do a laborious Gedanken or thought leave one out experiment to estimate the excess generalization error rate. Then we're going to compute a bound on that leave one out procedure so we don't actually have to run the procedure. So it's a two-step argument. Let's pretend we're doing our laborious leave one out argument. So let's call the set 1 dot 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 m, m underbar, just so we have a set. Let's call the set 1 dot 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 m of integers m with an underbar, just so we have a concise way of saying that, because we'll be saying that quite a lot. Now we're going to define our estimate, our laborious leave out one estimate, as e hat I equals 1 if fit m underbar minus I dot model x of I doesn't equal y of I, 0 otherwise. So this is just the error experienced by a leave one out procedure. The leave one out procedure fits on all of our training data except for the I throw, and then it applies itself to the I throw and sees how does this model that didn't see the I throw perform on this surprising row. This is a standard leave one out argument. Now, it requires some assumptions to work. For instance, if our model software crashed on even road data sets and worked on odd road data sets, then there would be no relation between the model fit on 100 rows and the model fit on 99 rows. So we're hoping basically our modeling procedure is very nice, which is a lot, most of them are. So you have that sort of sensitivity, then you have a very buggy modeling procedure. So we're assuming our modeling procedure is somewhat well-behaved to make the leave one out argument valid. The basis of the leave one argument out is a notion called exchangeability, that if we had another row, say x m plus 1, y m plus 1, outside of our training data set, well, when we do the leave one out on I, that model has not seen xi, yi, and has also not seen x m plus 1, y m plus 1. So to effect to that model, if every row was equally likely to be in every place, i.e. we shuffled the data initially, these two rows would remain exchangeable for the leave one out model because that model has not seen either of them, and we can design our data permutation such that they're each equally likely to be in the other position. So the expected error rate on xi is equal to the expected error rate on this unseen row. That's true for every time we repeat the experiment. So the leave one out under fairly mild assumptions, we do require some assumptions, estimates the error rate on an alien row we've never seen correctly in expectation. Now it is a somewhat bad estimate because all of these experiments, even though they're correct in expectation, are highly correlated with each other, so we don't get a good estimate on the variance. So we don't know how reliable the leave one out estimate is. We know in expectation it's right, but we don't know whether we're one of the universes where we had a bad result or we're one of the universes where the result was good. So however, this is a standard argument. We can estimate the generalization error or excess generalization error of the model on future data by a leave one out argument, arguing that the left out rows could be exchanged with a future row we've not seen, thus simulating out of sample performance. So that's a standard argument, and I'm sorry if I butchered that a little. Now, the only reason we don't run that is this requires running the entire modeling procedure m times over again. That's incredibly expensive. It's an expensive modeling procedure. If the modeling procedure takes a minute, and this is a million rows, then this is a million minutes. So we don't want to use the leave one out modeling procedure, even though it's correct, because it's very time expensive. So we're going to do our step two of two, bound the leave one out result without having ever run it. So we're going to assume we do have our one model, MS, and we're going to build a new estimate of error, EI circle. Now, if I is in our critical set, then EI is equal to EI hat. That's because by our critical set definitions, the leave one out model would fit the exact same model on M minus I as it fit on all of M. So the estimates, the predictions will be the same, therefore the errors will be the same. So if I is not in the critical set, sorry, said that wrong, if I is not in the critical set, then the errors EI circle equal the errors EI hat. We basically will just use our one model to simulate what the one-way holdout would have been, or leave one holdout been, without ever having to do the one, leave one holdout. So that's easy. It leaves us the case, what do we do for I in CS? Well, let's just be nasty and say it's one. That we're just going to assume for every I in the critical set, we get it wrong during leave one out holdout. And that actually completes the argument. Let's call E equals I in M such that EI circle equals one. So this is the set of errors we made. Well, this estimate is just, so the generalization error is just the size of the critical set plus the number of errors that weren't in the critical set over the number of rows. Because every place that we claim EI circle is an estimated error, either we are a row in the critical set, which is here, or we are a row not in the critical set where we made a mistake. So it'd be this set minus the critical set, so we don't double count it. Well, this is finished because E over M is the errors observed in the system, and this is the excess error term. This is how much is being elevated. So we know the excess generalization error is no more than this fraction. And this is the model size in some sense. It's how many rows are in the critical set. So this actually finishes our argument. The model behaves on its training set roughly like this. It has a number of errors divided by number of rows. We hope this fraction is near zero. And that is how many errors we actually really observed on held out things not involving the critical set, plus possibly the critical set. So the excess generalization error is bounded by this contribution here. So the idea is, if the model only picked up one row in 1,000, the critical set is only 1/1,000th of the training data, then we expect, in expectation, the error rate on future data should only be about 1/1,000th higher than on training data. That is a nice estimated expected value bound. And that is the entire argument. It just takes a while to set up the machinery and work it through. Thank you very much for your time.